Armed Forces Radio presents Theater of War, USA. Presented this week and every week till it's over. Over there. Okay there, gang. It's Harry Von Zell reminding you that it's time to join us once again for another session dedicated to answering your requests to Armed Forces Radio, Theater of War, USA. Tonight's melodrama takes place in the European theater, where our hero, surprise, surprise, it's a general, is surveying the battlefield somewhere near Elbeuf, France. Ready, maestro? Overture!
Victory march? Almost, not quite. With the enemy capital almost in sight, the famous battles have all been fought. But now, with such a sure way to go, the men of my division will not take chances as brave men ought. Good Lord, the enemy has launched a counterattack. And here's a soldier without a rifle, without a helmet, without a combat pack.
We don't want no more of your bullshit. We don't want no more of your bullshit. We don't want no more of your bullshit. We just want to go home.
Where's your gun?
Where's the sun?
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 This is division headquarters.
Why, yes, it is.
You're far from the front, and that's a crime.
We got the same idea at the very same time.
You can be shot for being back here.
I just want what we're fighting for.
What's that?
Freedom from fear.
You don't fool me, pretending to be crazy as a loon. Military police, military police, arrest this goon.
Yes, sir, yes, sir. We charge him with what, sir?
With saving my butt, sir.
You are an utter disgrace. Desertion in the face of the enemy.
If it please the court, I am innocent.
On what grounds?
I've never seen an enemy face.
Sir, he must be one of the replacements who arrived at noon and was sent straight to a platoon, which was taking on an awful pounding from enemy heavy artillery.
Nobody promised him a rose garden. At least I hope not.
All I know about the enemy is his ammo. It goes whammo, shammo, whammo, whammo. I look at the man next to me and his head fell off.
His head fell off? What was his name?
I just got here. I don't know anybody's name. His name should have been Fountain.
Why should it have been Fountain?
That's what his neck was after his head fell off.
We'll return. return to tonight's tale, but now a word about U.S. war bonds. Friends, somewhere in England, a limping plane, trembling in every joint, circles slowly into the wind, says she has wounded aboard, and crash lands. Her fuselage riddled with cannon and bullet holes, a gaping wrench in her tail, two motors gone, her left wing spar hanging by a splinter. Literally, she has come home on a wing and a prayer. We who stay behind can't match the spirit of those boys who miss death by inches. But we can show them our spirit. We can buy war bonds. Let's buy and buy more and more bonds and hurry them home. Brought to you by Studebaker, builders of Cyclone engines for the Boeing Flying Fortress. And now we'll return to our soldier's story. The scene is in a French farmhouse where an enemy sniper died.
He looked 14. We blew out the roof and all the windows and doors with him inside. His helmet's hanging over there, hanging on a rusty nail. And now this ruined frog farmhouse doubles as a makeshift jail. Hidey, 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 ho.
Hidey, 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 ho.
Hidey, 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 ho.
Hidey, 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 ho.
It is now my duty to read to the prisoner who could take no more. Article number 58 from the Articles of War.
We're Captain Rogers Rangers, we're riders of the night. We're horny sons of bitches and we'd rather fuck than fight. What's going on?
The CO called Corps, Corps called Army, Army called the commander of the whole damn theater.
Who called the creator?
I want you to listen, and listen good. The general wants this clearly understood.
How much wood could a woodchuck chuck if a woodchuck could chuck wood? Hidey, 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 ho.
Hidey, 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 ho.
Hidey, 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 ho.
Hidey, 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 ho.
Article 58.
I love it already.
The penalty for misbehavior in the face of the enemy.
Never saw one.
Shall be dishonorable discharge from the service.
Heaven, can I go home now?
Forfeiture of all pay and allowances.
Like losing a button off an overcoat.
And being shot to death by a firing squad.
We'll return to our story, but first, the news from the front. Hitler has gambled everything in the Ardennes. Bastogne must be taken. After totally surrounding our forces, the 101st has dug itself into field and forest to hold the town. German officers, under a white flag of truce, enter our regiment to demand surrender. General McAuliffe takes a pencil and writes to the Nazis, "Nuts!" Exclamation point. General Eisenhower at Supreme Headquarters regroups his forces, giving Montgomery complete command over the northern sector. Britain's famous Monty cleverly holds Rundstedt in the north. His American counterpart, Bradley, blocks the Nazis in the south. The tide is turning in the Battle of the Bulge as the Nazis retreat from France. Now back to tonight's vignette. And I think you'll recognize the little girl who's about to walk on stage.
Shaving cream, toothpaste, and dental floss. Coffee, donuts, Red Cross. Red Cross, Red Cross, Red Cross. Anybody in there?
There ain't nobody here but us chickens. Go away.
Are you nuts? Come in, come in.
Don't tell her what I'm here for.
I thought you were proud of yourself.
Give me a gun and I'll kill myself.
Shit. Brighten up while I get the door. They haven't shot anybody in this man's army for what you did since the Civil War, since 1865.
With my luck,
Entrez, entrez, mademoiselle, s'il vous plaît.
What can the Red Cross do to thank you for all the heroic things I'm sure you did today?
How about a little kiss?
Please, you mustn't talk that way, even in jest. I'm sure you understand.
He forgot for a minute he was an enlisted man.
How about some scalding hot coffee instead?
Him first. He killed so many enemies today, his rifle burned up, and he had to throw it away. He's back here till they can find him a new one.
I never know how much to believe of what soldiers say.
I'm back here because they're going to shoot me for cowardice. I also have body lice.
Hear how modest he is? That's congressional medal material there if I ever saw it. It isn't enough to show bravery. You also have to have what he has, which is practically unbelievable modesty.
It's true, isn't it?
What is?
What he just said. I heard they caught a deserter and wanted to make an example of him. That's who he is, and you're his guard. I'm so sorry. Life at the front is very hard.
Unpleasant.
And he thinks he'll get shot like a pheasant. But they won't do that. I've guarded 100 deserters like him so far, and 5 years from now, they'll all be out of prison tending bar.
Not me.
Why would you say a thing like that?
I want to be shot. I deserve to be shot. I need to be shot.
Oh, God! I had no idea this job would be so depressing.
Folks, you'll want to know that according to a recent nationwide survey, more doctors smoke Camels than any other cigarette. Three outstanding independent research organizations asked not just a few thousand, but 113,000 doctors from coast to coast to name their favorite cigarette. The answer came by truckloads, from general physicians, surgeons, even nose and throat specialists. The most named brand was Camel. If you're not now smoking Camels, compare them critically. See how the full, rich flavor suits your taste. See how the cool mildness of a Camel suits your throat. And remember, Camels, costlier tobacco. Well, things have certainly been looking rough for our friends. Let's check back in with them. Over where?
Ted, hut!
At ease. Please. We're all human beings here. With the windows and doors all shot out and no roof overhead.
It's hard to forget you're a general, sir! And we're just two pieces of shit by comparison, sir!
Speak for yourself.
It would be so easy to handle you if only we were back in garrison. A month on KP, then another month cleaning latrines. And after that, I doubt very much if he'd be so full of beans.
He isn't full of beans, sir!
He sure is when he talks to me.
That's just bluff, sir! He wants to be shot by a firing squad!
He what?
With a black blindfold, sir, and a last cigarette. Even though I don't smoke.
I am here to tell you that this is no damn joke.
Maybe a shot of brandy or gin just before they march me out. Like a movie starring Errol Flynn, the great Coxman.
Pull up your socks, man. That's exactly what he wants me to do. The commander of this whole damn theater.
Who has no doubt consulted with his creator.
I don't know if he has or not. But he wants you shot.
Then he talked to the creator for goddamn sure. One thing I figured out about the creator, and it's true of the army too. There's nothing wrong with life that death can't cure. I quite agree with them.
Your two-star lover is a total wreck.
The least the Red Cross can do is rub your neck.
I led the landings on Sicily.
And by no means Priscilly.
I led the assault on Omaha Beach.
The theater commander himself got the landing at Perfect Peach.
I led the spearhead into Gay Paris.
And the frogs were so grateful to be once again free.
The French, they are a peculiar race. They fight with their feet, and they fuck with their face.
You should have been a philosopher.
Betty?
My name is Patty.
Patty? All of a sudden, I'm going batty. I should have military cemeteries named after me all over this theater. But now I've been ordered to shoot just one man for cowardice.
He also has body lice.
We all do.
Speak for yourself. How about some scalding hot coffee?
And I want to say screw it. I simply cannot do it.
Whatever.
Whatever happened to Betty?
She died in the service of her nation. She stepped on a landmine while on her way to a delousing station.
How are you coming? A tear-jerking alibi.
In a pig's eye, it's a hymn in praise of the military profession. A soldier bad as I am should be dead. That's what I said. I'm honored and grateful to have this second chance while shitting in my pants. To give my life for my country.
Red Cross, Red Cross, shaving cream, toothpaste, and dental floss, coffee and donuts, Red Cross, Red Cross, Red Cross, Red Cross.
Entrez, entrez, mademoiselle, s'il vous plaît.
I have just come from your division commander, who I think you will agree is one in a million.
At the very least.
The determination of your prisoner to die for nothing.
To raise morale.
It is rapidly turning a once fearless general into a chicken-hearted civilian. I brought you something he thought you should see. It's a manual on the organization and duties of a firing squad dated 1863.
Hot stuff.
I thought it was awful.
Wrong. It's beautiful because it's lawful. By the way, what was the general in civilian life?
He was a hotel detective.
The place of execution will be prepared to provide for a back wall made of absorbent material before which the prisoner will be placed. An upright post will be placed in front of the back wall and will be used to support the prisoner if necessary. If, while the condemned is being prepared for or marched to the place of execution, collapse has taken place or is imminent, a suitable brace board and straps will be adjusted. A firing squad in charge of a sergeant consisting of not less than 8 and no more than 12 enlisted men skilled in the use of the regulation rifle will be selected by the officer designated to carry out the act of execution. When the hood has been adjusted and signal given that the prisoner is in final readiness, the firing squad will be marched by the sergeant to a designated spot and formed in single or double rank facing the prisoner and not less than 20 paces from him. The members of the firing squad will be armed with regulation rifles, each of which will have been loaded and the pieces locked by the officer charged with the execution of the sentence. One of the rifles will contain a blank round, and the identity of this piece will not be disclosed.
So we shot him. That's the editorial we, of course. In this story, his last words were...
I said them through the hood. I don't know if anybody understood.
And they were...
I regret that I have only one life to lose for my country.
No more dumb rhymes.
The audience should know, though...
You just rhymed.
Accident. The audience should know that the part I played was based very loosely on the true story of the execution of an American Army private named Eddie D. Slovak.
Serial number 3689-6415.
The first number, the 3, indicates that he wasn't a volunteer, but a draftee. Excuse the rhyme. Old habits die hard.
On August 25th, 1944, he was sent as a replacement, fresh from basic training, to G Company 109th Infantry Regiment.
28th Division, which was then engaged in heavy fighting, although the war was all but won, near Elbeuf.
France! He didn't know anyone in that whole division, and he had never fought before.
He deserted immediately, not once, but twice. And he confessed twice that he had deserted.
He acknowledged that he should be shot for that.
And no American soldier had ever been shot for cowardice since 1865.
Since the war between the states.
Since the Civil War.
The only American soldier to be shot for cowardice since 1865 and up to this moment died of multiple wounds at 10 in the morning on January 31st, 1945.
The war he may have helped to win at least a little bit by setting such a bad example would end in 3 more months.
He was shot in the garden in winter time.
The man who signed his death warrant was General Dwight David Eisenhower.
Years later, General Eisenhower was asked to comment on the unique position in American military history to which he has assigned Eddie Slovak.
And the general, then retired to his estate, is said to have replied,
as a matter of fact, I approved that one. It was for a repeated case of desertion. The man refused to believe that he would ever be executed. At the very last moment, I sent my judge advocate general to see him, and I said, if you serve in your company honorably, and until the war is over, you'll get an honorable discharge and not the death sentence. He said,
baloney.
Or words to that effect. And so, he was executed.
Gang, what a great show. In the role of the private, you heard Billy Pilgrim. The MP was played by Elliot Rosewater. As the Red Cross girl, Montana Wildhack. Playing the general, Kilgore Trout. And for Armed Forces Radio in the Theater of War USA Orchestra, this is Harry Von Zell. Good night, all.